Donna went down to Georgia. Said he was trying to stop the steal. Dems were unkind. They were way behind, while Biden just copped a feel.
When they came upon this orange man rallying millions on the spot, the Democrats cried and yelled in line and said, "Don, let me tell you what. I guess you didn't know it, but we're politicians and you're screwed. And if you care to take a dare, we'll make a bet with you. Now you pretend to love this country, boy, but give us rhinos our due. We'll bet the presidency and democracy just to think that we can out-cheat even you." He said, "My middle name's Johnny, and it might do me in. But I'll take your bet you're gonna regret, because America will win.
Deplorables, rise up and show we won't be beaten down. Because cheaters cheat and haters hate, and they're a bunch of clowns. And when we win, we'll keep our country free and rich and whole. But if we lose, the socialists take control."
Rhinos threw out every case and said it's just a show, and acid spew a CNN and only watched his fan base grow. They pulled out all the stops and schemes and nearly formed a coup, and all the media joined in and censored it from you. When the SCOTUS finished, Johnny said, "We'll make another run. Let Biden sniff Kamala's hair while we prosecute his son.
Fire up the MAGA folks, Proud Boys run. The devil's got the house, but not our guns. Chickens wear a mask and cause distress. Dead granny judge a vote count. Yes, child, yes."
The demos scoffed and smirked, expecting Trump's hasty retreat, and Nancy withheld help bills to keep small business on its feet.
The Donald took in all their flack and threw it back again. "We're gonna keep America great, you witch, cause it's the best it's ever been.
Fire up the MAGA folks, Proud Boys run. The devil's got the house, but not our guns. Chickens wear a mask and cause distress. Dead granny does your vote count. Yes, child, yes."
And now, CCW News presents Holy Crap! This is actually happening! Scary but True Edition, All Hallows Eve 2023. I'm Chuck U. Farley. While Hamas continues to pummel both Israel and U.S. troops, the Weezer-in-Chief swore that if they didn't let up, he'd retaliate with the ferocity of a sternly worded letter. If that. Meanwhile, all three leaders of Hamas, Hezbollah, and the Israeli Jihad met in Beirut, in a Four Seasons hotel, all in one place at once. No, I swear I am not making this up. The three most wanted terrorist leaders had a powwow in plain sight, and the only thing they were shot with was media cameras. Congress was finally able to vote in a new Speaker of the House. Louisiana Representative Mike Johnson was voted in unanimously by Republicans, garnering a collective public outcry of, "Who in the hell is Mike Johnson?" Once the Democrats figured out that he is a Christian, they immediately labeled him as a racist homophobe. When they found out that he and his wife took in and raised a troubled black teen decades ago, they decried that he isn't in any current family photos. Michael, who is now 40 and has a family of his own, is doing just fine. No thanks to Democrats. and he's happy being a successful man without the burden of tokenism the left wants to inflict upon him. This, of course, made Democrats hate Speaker Johnson even more, which kind of makes the rest of us like him. As if it weren't dystopian enough to see mobs of college students throughout the U.S. calling for the extermination of the Jews, the New York Times hired an actual Hitler worshipper to cover the war in Israel. No, I solemnly swear I am not making this up. In other news you won't see on the mainstream, pharma god Pfizer, which literally made billions as the Biden totalitarian regime force-injected government employees and armed service members with vaccines that didn't vaccinate against anything, used a combination of delayed reporting and outright cover-ups to hide the fact that test subjects who got their jabs sustained near 4 times more cardiac deaths than the general population. According to the International Journal of Vaccine Theory, Practice, and Research, your tax dollars paid for the corporate darling to cover up nearly 80% of the deaths caused by their product. And that was just during testing. This reporter wonders how many they're covering up for now. The state of Oregon has learned that its students are so dumb that they can't read, write, or do basic math. So they voted unanimously that learning how to do so will no longer be required to graduate. Because now it's racist to actually learn anything at all. Even though presidential candidate RFK Jr. has had his life threatened multiple times, the Marxist-weaponized DOJ still refuse him the Secret Service protection afforded to all other candidates, including the Cabbage in Chief's former boss Barack Obama, because if there's one thing the USA can count on, it's the CIA gunning for a Kennedy. For CCW News, this has been Holy Crap! This is actually happening! I'm Chuck U. Farley. Good night, and may God help us.
Welcome to CounterCultureWISE, a Stormcap production. The views expressed on this podcast are those of the hosts, our guests, and the dog, and do not necessarily reflect the views of any of our platforms, our advertisers, or any other dog.
As you listen today, please remember, queer is so much more than a podcast. All of our stories we discuss are linked in our show notes on CounterCultureWISE.com. Visit there for commentary, guest photos and links, animations, and fun merchandise.
If you have a story idea or would like to be a guest on our show, contact us via our website. You can also follow us on Twitter, Gab, Instagram, Facebook, and all over social media, where we'll post memes, cat pics, and commentary that gets us booted off on a regular basis.
If you're listening live, be sure to join our chat on Spreaker. If you're listening dead, please stop voting Democrat, but enjoy the show anyway. And a hearty hello and howdy doody to everybody out there listening in Counterculture Wise Land. Welcome to Time Travel Day!
Yay!
Did you
we
set your
clock?
Step into
the future.
Yes, step into the future. Unfortunately, if you have pets that expect to be fed at a certain time, they don't adjust for daylight savings.
Well, they sure didn't this morning. I was up at 5:30.
No, we were up at 4:30.
I don't know. It was well before
nobody knows
six.
What time it is anymore.
Well, it was, yeah.
But they did. They did, and God bless them.
God do something to them.
Ow. Well, welcome, welcome, welcome to another episode of Counterculture Wise Dead Kim, where we share the news of the weird, wonderful, and wicked. Rrr. Folks, I am your hostess with the mostest, and in the background you can hear the dogs chewing
which we
on their hooves.
Hear, yeah,
you shouldn't be able to hear them, but oh boy, are they really, really into them, so I do apologize for the grinding in the background. Just remember, every sound you hear in the background is a happy, happy dog. Anybody
Until
want a dog?
Anymore. Whatever.
Anybody want a dog?
Yeah, okay.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, here we are in CounterCultureWISE Studios, packing up, getting ready to move. Don't know where we're going to end up, but for now, we're here with the grinding dogs chewing on their happy, happy bones. I am your hostess with the mostest, Ms. Melanie Hope, and here with me in studio is the handsome, the intelligent, the charming. He's looking around because he doesn't know who I'm talking about. My best friend, the man I happen to marry, on purpose even, my sweet babu, Mr. James Modus!
Oh, thanks, everybody. Thank you. Thank you. You're all cheering me up. I had a rough morning.
It was a rough morning.
Yeah. I was singing in the shower, and
I'm doing great.
Until I got soap in my mouth, and then it turned into a soap opera.
It's soap opera.
Get on it.
I got it. Somewhere.
It was a soap opera.
I can't find it. There it is.
Thank you. I'm not going to keep doing these jokes.
It doesn't count as an opera if you're singing We Represent the Lollipop Guild, okay? I'm just saying there's opera and then there's...
And now we're dissecting Jim's dad jokes. All right, whatever. Yeah, I'll just have some fun anyway.
Well, we got a big, strong, happy babu in the chat. So welcome, my sweet babu. Okay, well, we have kind of a sort of newish-esque segment. but I thought before we head into that, I would educate. You know, I'm an edumacator.
Yes.
I edumacate kids on a daily basis. I cram knowledge through any
their
orifice.
Unwitting little heads.
Anything I can just shove up the nose and the ear holes and the eyeballs, whatever it takes, I will shove smarts into my kids. So I thought, yeah, maybe I'll share a little bit of that with you. So let's talk about the history of daylight saving time.
I want to know.
Yeah.
Because this is the dumbest thing.
It's the stupidest pain
in the
ass.
It's the dumbest thing in the history of
Arizona.
Nobody in the United States of America wants this anymore.
Nobody on any planet wants this. Arizona's the only one who gets it right, which means that I have to adjust every friggin' thing
for
my
Arizona
students. Okay.
Right.
First of all, it's daylight saving time. And we always say savings, but no, there's no S. So DST is daylight saving time. Okay. Supposedly is used to save energy and make better use of daylight. And a lot of people credit Benjamin Franklin for this nonsense, but he had nothing to do with it.
I'll
in
be
fact,
darned.
The U.S.
See,
wasn't
I actually
even
learned
involved.
That in school, which is...
Yeah.
Which means the educational system is
hello.
Jacked.
Just saying, yeah, he had nothing to do with it.
Next thing you're going to tell me, the Washington didn't chop down a cherry tree.
What? We'll have to talk about that offline, Jimmy.
Oh no!
Yeah.
Don't tell me. All right. Well,
this
whatever.
Happened
whatever.
Well, and I mean well after Benjamin Franklin. This actually happened in 1908.
Yeah, I think he was gone by then.
Yeah, very gone. guess where?
I have
Communist
no idea.
China, Socialist Germany. No, Canada. Blame Canada. Yeah, this started in Canada. Has Canada ever been on the right side of history? Like, ever?
They sided with us in World War II, I think.
Do they even have an army? Do they even have a military?
They
just like exist up there and like play like they're a country, but they're not. They're not.
I've
I mean,
been
they,
there. It's different.
It's not. Yeah, they have the queen on their money.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they're not their own country. They never have been. Okay, so daylight saving time is the practice of setting the clocks 1 hour ahead of standard time to make use of more sunlight in the spring, summer, and fall, supposedly. While Germany and Austria were the first countries to US DST in 1916, it is a little-known fact that a few hundred Canadians beat the German Empire by 8 years. On July 1st, add insult to injury, 1908, the residents of Port Arthur, Ontario, which is now known as Thunder Bay, turned their clocks forward by 1 hour to start the world's first daylight saving time period.
They're the ones to blame. Destroy them. Destroy them. Destroy them.
Hamas on them. Hamas
I haven't.
Jihad on Canadians. Okay.
Yeah, jihad on Canadians.
Other locations in Canada soon followed suit. On April 23rd, 1914, Regina in Saskatchewan implemented DST.
I think that's Regina, actually.
It could be, but
Regina.
I've been to Saskatchewan. I have. And it was Regina when I was there, but okay, I was a little
Regina.
Girl, so I could be wrong. Implemented DST, the cities of Winnipeg and Brandon in Manitoba did so on April 24th, 1916, according to the April 3rd, 1916 edition of the Manitoba Free Press. Daylight saving time in Regina proved so popular that bylaw now brings it into effect automatically. So that's a quote. Proved so popular. Uh-huh. Right. However, the idea did not catch on globally until who's the other country that's always on the wrong side of history?
Every single one of them?
Of all the countries on the planet, if you can think of the one country that is always on the wrong side of history, that always gets it wrong 100% of the time, even today, what country comes to mind?
Germany?
Yeah. Germany introduced DST in 1916. Clocks in the German Empire and its ally, Austria, were turned ahead by 1 hour on April 30th, 1916, 2 years into World War I. The rationale was to minimize the use of artificial lighting to save fuel for the war effort. You cannot see his gesture, but...
It's not something that I should be
doing. It's not
doing.
Child-friendly.
It's not child-friendly, and honestly, it's not something I should be doing, and I apologize. Just leave it alone, Melanie, and move on.
Woo! Within a few weeks, the United Kingdom, France, and many other countries followed the idea. Most of them reverted to standard time after World War I, and it wasn't until the next World War that DST made its return in most of Europe.
So if you
think daylight saving time is a good idea, you can thank New Zealand. Scientist George Vernon Hudson and British builder William Willett. Okay. In 1895, Hudson presented a paper to the Wellington Philosophical Society proposing a two-hour shift. Can you imagine doing 2 hours?
No.
A two-hour shift forward in October and a two-hour shift back in March. There was interest in the idea, but it was never followed through.
Thank God. One hour
is hard enough. Good God. In 1905, independently from Hudson, British builder William Willett suggested setting the clocks ahead 20 minutes on each of the four Sundays in April and switching them back by the same amount on each of the 40 Sundays.
Oh, let's really complicate things.
But at least you're easing into it 20 minutes at a time. I think even the pets would have adjusted to that. A total of 8 time switches per year.
I wouldn't be able to keep up, dude.
We're just not smart enough for that.
People in general.
I can do calculus,
smart.
But I can't change my clocks 20 minutes.
That's asking way too much of your fellow man. I think you got way too much faith.
Way too much. All right, so Willett's daylight saving plan caught the attention of Robert Pierce, a British member of Parliament, and he introduced a bill to the House of Commons in February 1908. The first daylight saving bill was drafted in 1909, Screw You Britain, presented to Parliament several times and examined by a select committee. However,
I beg your pardon, you insufferable twit.
You're wearing a wig. Shut up. However, a powdered wig. However, many, especially farmers... Hello, can't get the cows to wake up an hour early. Opposed the idea, so the bill was never made into a law. Well, it died in 1915, the year before the United Kingdom started using DST in May 1916. It is not known if he was aware that his idea had become a reality 7 years before his death in a small town in, guess where? Ontario.
Where's Ontario? In old Ontario.
Not so much Britain. Okay. So a lot of people credit Benjamin Franklin with it, but he, in 1784, they say, can hardly be described as the fundamental for the development of this. It didn't even involve turning the clocks. In a letter to the editor of the Journal of Paris entitled, quote, "An Economic Project for Diminishing the Cost of Light," end quote. Keep in mind, no electricity, candles, yardy yardy. Franklin simply suggested that Parisians, because he lived in Paris at the time, could economize candle usage by getting people out of bed earlier in the morning. And what's more, Benjamin Franklin, who we all know was a trickster, he meant it as a joke. So what we have implemented globally, he saw as a joke. He thought it was...
He wasn't wrong.
Yeah.
That makes me hold him in even higher esteem than I did before.
Imagine changing your clocks throughout the entire planet because Saturday Night Live did a shtick about it. That's basically what happened. Okay. It's now used in over 70 countries worldwide to fix over 1 billion people... Oh, I think this is way outdated. It affects way more than 1 billion. When was this written? This it doesn't say. Blast. It's way more than 1 billion.
Anyway.
Yeah. And it sucks and it's stupid and I hate it. And so...
I have a proposal. Okay. I've got something for you.
All right.
If you are running for president of the United States, it could be the Communist Party of the USA. It could be the Republicans. It could be the Libertarians.
You could be black, white, blue, purple, orange.
Matter. If they propose to destroy daylight saving time forever,
nationwide,
they'll get elected. They'll get elected. Yeah. If Trump wants to get reelected, like have an absolute landslide, all he has to do is say, "I will get rid of daylight saving times." Nobody wants it. Who in the hell wants this? I'm sorry. Who in the heck wants this?
Nobody. Ever.
Absolute asininity.
We, the United States of America, need to stand united and say no. No more daylight saving. No more. We're done. We stand with Arizona. They may not be able to elect their own governor, but by dang, they stopped daylight saving.
Oh, man.
We don't burn candles anymore, people. It's time to come into the current century.
We don't burn wax candles.
It's current year.
In Arizona.
It's current year, and it's time to stop. All right.
All right. So,
you want to talk about the TDSer of the week?
Before we do.
Speaking of, you know, Orange Man leading the nation.
Yeah. Well, go ahead. That's fine.
No, it's all you. You had something to say.
Oh, I just wanted to say that I'm sure most of you have already listened to it or are interested in it, but we listened to the new Beatles single, which is supposed to be the very last one ever.
So they say.
And this was, it was good. It was a good way to end
I'll
it.
Be it's, honest, I teared up a little.
Yeah. I mean, this is not the return of Strawberry Fields Forever.
No.
It's not even the return of Free as a Bird, to be totally frank with you, but...
That one teared me up,
It was
too.
A good song. It was a good song.
I sincerely enjoyed it. I teared up a little.
Mm.
But that's, you know, like a super, uber, mega fan.
Yeah.
Like
the video, I know Melanie probably hasn't seen it, but the video is really good.
Will it make me, like, sob uncontrollably and
I
end
don't,
up in the fetal
Melanie,
position?
There are days when a bird landing on the bird feeder...
But it's a birdie on my bird feeder, and I fed the birdie. Of course I'm going to be happy and joyful when the birdie lands on my bird. I put the food out there
the
for the birdie.
If the song tugged at your heartstrings, the video will too, okay? But it's essentially, for those of you who don't know, this was based on a demo that John Lennon recorded in the late 70s. I think it was 77. And then
that far back.
In the 90s, right after the Beatles got inducted into the Hall of Fame, I think it was,
Yoko gave a copy of these demos that John recorded to the rest of the Beatles. Two of them, Free as a Bird and Real Love, were, they blended in their own voices and their own instrumentation, added some lines and all kind of stuff, and it wound up on the Anthology 1 and 2 albums. The third song that they were trying to do was Now and Then, which turned out to be the single that was just released. It was very poorly recorded. It was just a an old cassette tape with John banging on a piano and singing. I've heard the demo. It sounds amazing, you know, because it's John, not because of anything else.
Right.
But the acoustics, I think that Paul and Ringo did, and all the production people did an amazing job on it.
My first question was, how did they get a guitar solo? What did they do with George?
That's easy, because they did try to work on it during the Free as a Bird sessions for the Anthology.
Okay.
And they were able to, they messed about with it as British people. They messed about. They did that for
about... It was just rubbish.
It was just rubbish. And that's exactly what George thought of the John song.
Really?
He thought it was effing rubbish. That was his quote.
George said that. But he still laid down a track for his guitar.
It's John Lennon. And George said, still fucking rubbish. So, yeah, he did. So they shelved it. Because it didn't sound good. Because if you listen to the demo, there's this hum through the whole thing, and plus there are times when the piano is louder than John's voice,
mm-hmm.
So there wasn't any way to really work at it. So what they did...
They had to wait until the technology caught up.
Okay. And Paul saw an opportunity. So the guy, Peter Jackson, you know, the geeks and nerds know him as the director of Lord of the Rings. Beatles fans know him as the guy who produced the Get Back documentary, which we still haven't watched. We're going to have to watch that. But
yeah.
He used AI to separate sound, to separate voices from music, to present the audio in its absolute best. So John and Ringo and Yoko, whoever represents George, decided to use this same technology. So they used George's guitar from the sessions where they tried to work on Now and Then back in 1995.
I was wondering about that. So they did actually try.
They actually tried.
And George did actually lay down some tracks.
He did lay down some guitar tracks.
But he still said it was crap and didn't want to do it.
I think he would have approved Now. But there's also background vocals from Here, There, and Everywhere from... Because the sky.
I totally heard that.
And yeah, you can hear it. It's pretty obvious. And so they did that. Ringo played really well. Ringo, I think they used some of George's vocals from the attempt to do Now and Then before. If not, anyway, he's in the background vocals for the other stuff. So George, Ringo, and Paul all added vocals. Paul and Ringo very recently.
Yeah.
And I'm going to just give you a preview. The video, there's like all kinds of imagery of the Beatles throughout the years, right?
Of course.
It's a Beatles video. What are you expecting? Yeah. But there's a part where Paul and Ringo, the octogenarians, modern day video of them, and then there's video of John and George on either side of them back in the mid-60s during the Sgt. Pepper era, playing along with them.
Yeah, I'm totally going to cry.
Yeah, she'll be boo-hooing into
it. I'll be boo-hooing, yeah.
But, you know, that's okay. So that's the story of it. They really put a lot of work into it. They hired strings. They hired a small orchestra. Didn't tell them what it was for, although Paul was there at the sessions. But they didn't...
They didn't tell them?
They didn't tell them.
Why?
Because they didn't want the secret let out.
Oh.
This was months ago.
Oh.
So, yeah, this was not some, this took a while for them to get ready. So, yeah, that would have.
How could you be a violinist or, you know, celloist and be like, wait, this is a Beatles song. How could you not know?
I don't know.
I'd be like three notes in, I'm like, this is a Beatles song.
Yeah.
Bound on the Run. Yeah.
One of Paul's best. But anyway, That's the story of that. I think it's very odd. We live in very odd times when the Rolling Stones have a number one album and the Beatles have a new single.
It just speaks to the fact that we ruined... Well, okay, it wasn't us, though. Gen X, we did our best, but we just got skipped over.
Yeah.
The boomers ruined the next two generations.
Yeah, except for the music.
Except for the music. Yeah. And every time, I mean, I have students that are, you know, I have one student who's like, oh, I need to take this time off because we're going to go see this band or whatever. And I'm like, oh, my God, your parents are amazing. They mm-hmm. you know, and they recognize music and they're not listening to WAP and, you know, yeah, well, god-awful the nasty cool stuff.
I mean, I think this speaks to the enduring quality. I mean,
of I feel good music.
Good music. I mean, yeah. Sinatra, they release new albums by Sinatra. I mean, yeah, they're greatest hits collections, but they sell really well.
I'm working with 17 and 18-year-olds who have taken up, you know, jazz piano or mm-hmm. whatever, and they're playing Sinatra.
And they're into Bill Evans.
Yeah.
You know, and Tony Bennett and all and this great
actual,
music.
There's actual arguments online, mm-hmm. You know, who's the best drummer and, you know, how great was Ringo and this and that. And the mere fact, even people who disagree, the mere fact that they're arguing about it,
yeah.
it actually makes me happy. Does so, they yeah, even I know? Because there's nothing worse than talking to a kid and they're like, I don't know who the Beatles are.
Well, I mean, if you are above a certain age and you don't know who, I'll use a few more examples, Michael Jackson or Elvis Presley, come mm-hmm. on, wake up.
Yeah.
I mean, I saw Sinatra for the first time. I really knew who he was when I was 10 years old.
Yeah, he was long.
I was 10 years old when I heard Sinatra, and he was, you know, amazing. And this was his later years. This wasn't even going back to the best stuff he did right. in the 50s and 60s. This was the mid-1970s.
I mean, I remember I was a little child,
mm-hmm.
and I remember my mom sobbing. And telling me that John Lennon had been killed. I mm-hmm. didn't know who that was.
Right.
But she educated me.
Right.
And, you know, I grew up on Beatles music. And when she told me, oh, he is one of the Beatles, I was like, oh, my gosh. And I was just a little kid.
Right. I was. You know? I remember that night, sadly, very, very, very well.
Yeah.
Little House on the Prairie had just started.
Oh.
Now, I wasn't watching it. I was in the other room.
I love that show.
But you know, then an NBC special report, and they, that's... And it's like, are you kidding me?
My mom tried to shield me from it because I had grown up on Beatles music.
Uh-huh.
And so she just assumed that I knew the names of all the Beatles. But mm-hmm. I was a little kid. I didn't pay attention.
No, I was.
I knew
my initial exposure
names.
To the Beatles was the ABC cartoon series.
You've seen
bits and pieces of
you
that,
were
right?
the one who exposed me to that. I didn't even know that was a thing.
Yeah, that was my first exposure to the Beatles. And then several years later, I'm in this drugstore in San Pedro. We were in that neighborhood when we went to the Starbucks. It was across the street from there. There was a drugstore. And I'm flipping through records, and there's all these bands I'd never heard of with really cool album covers like Pink Floyd.
Yeah.
Cheech and Chong. I mean, I'd never heard of these before. And I thought, well, that's a cool name, Cheech and Chong. I wonder what they do. And the Pink Floyd album,
oh my God.
It was there.
I totally had watched all the Cheech and Chong movies when I was a baby, and I knew Cheech and Chong.
I finally come up on Beatles, the Red Album, which is about to be re-released with an extra LP for reasons I have no idea, except to make money. Because it's all the same stuff we all already have, but okay. But yeah, and I'm like, oh my gosh, they're real people. These weren't just cartoon characters. And I looked on the back on the sticker, and it had all these songs. I'm like, they did all of those?
Oh, that's so sad.
And it's like,
you
then I saw the Blue Album, and it's like, they did Hey Jude?
That was...
I was like 7 or 8 years old.
The Red and Blue, like, LP,
uh-huh.
that was a birthday present that my stepdad, mm-hmm. Sam, who's been on this show, he gave me, oh God, I was like 17 or 18 because mm-hmm. I was such a big Beatles fan. Mm-hmm. But I can't imagine a time in my life, like all the way back to where I had the little, they were called record players, but basically you had the plastic discs, and it was like they played ding 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 ding, and it was like the little mm-hmm. head actually just lifted up the notes. All the way back to then,
mm-hmm.
to my best friend Sabrina, God love her, she is an amazing human being, Michael Jackson fan. She introduced me to Michael Jackson. Mm-hmm. And my mom with the Beatles. Mm-hmm. And so outside of, you know, nursery songs, uh-huh, all the way back to, you know, 4 and 5 and 6 years old, mm-hmm, nursery songs, Michael Jackson and the Beatles.
Right.
And I can't even imagine my life without them.
And the thing is, I grew up in Southern California in the 60s. Do you know how legendary the radio stations and DJs were?
I wasn't to this, born yet, so
to
no.
This very, no, to this very day, I mean...
So is that like WKRP?
And that's fakery. I'm talking about the
real stuff. But isn't
that
kind of the...
Yeah. But you had the real Don Steele. You had... I mean, when he died, that made national news. Charlie Tuna, Art LeBeau, M.G. Kelly, also known as Machine Gun Kelly... All these, I mean, and they were all legendary, and I got to hear them every day, just a matter of fact. And they were playing stuff back then. It's kind of like a jack radio format.
Nowadays,
would be now,
yeah,
where they played, okay, we're going to play the Supremes. Now we're going to play the Beatles. Now we're going to play the Strawberry Alarm Clock. Now we're going to play Kenny Rogers on the First Edition, and so on and so on and so on. I was blessed.
See, all of
that
was done by the time I was old enough to understand. But my parents were musicians.
That era passed in like 1975, and
because
it gave way to FM radio,
right,
and all the, you know, all the more progressive
stuff. And that's kind of where I came into consciousness was FM radio. But I remember in Washington State,
mm-hmm,
KJR and I can't remember the other one.
There was, the main pop station back then was KJR.
Yeah, and they would do Breakfast with the Beatles, and mm-hmm, then KSW, which was the hard rock station, and mm-hmm, they kind of took that over.
Yeah.
But
then,
I remember.
And then there was KZOK, which
KZOK,
started off as a,
yeah, that was
as
the
a
classic
hard rock station,
right,
and then by the time I had moved to the area, they'd
right
transitioned into classic rock.
So I only knew KZOK as classic rock and mm-hmm KJR as well.
Right.
KSW was always the hard rock station, but KZOK
was the one.
I
love that station.
KZOK was the one that did Breakfast with the Beatles,
mm-hmm,
and that was a tradition in our family. While mm-hmm we were getting ready to go to church, we'd play Breakfast with the Beatles, mm-hmm, and we kind of sort of still do that.
Yeah.
I mean, even today, while you were taking a shower, you were blasting the Beatles. And
yeah. It's just, I mean, nowadays, I couldn't tell you the call letters to more than 2 or 3 radio stations here in the Waco area. I couldn't back in Las Vegas either. I knew a handful.
It's a different time.
But now it's all on, and I do this for several reasons. I mean, we more or less keep the Christian radio station on, one of the two music stations.
He teases me because every time he starts the car, he hears the Jeebus station.
Yeah.
Jeebus!
Actually, I would listen to it on my drive this afternoon. It's a lot easier to take than a lot of the hard rock stuff nowadays. I mean, I keep thinking about the 90s, the last great era of rock, in my opinion. And it all was happening in the Seattle area where Melanie and
yep
I were.
Yep.
And it's like Nirvana, Alice in Chains, Soundgarden, fantastic bands. Every single one of their lead singers off themselves to create such beautiful music and be so incredibly troubled. And, you know, there's something they were haunted by demons. And, you know, I don't want to sound like a prude, but because I still listen to the stuff, but I don't know. I like the old stuff better.
In chat, they're reminding us about Bob Rivers. And I'm like, yeah,
Bob Rivers was amazing.
We aspire to their.
Yeah. Spike and Joe and all
Spike
those guys.
And, yeah,
absolutely.
We aspire to their
amazing
parodies.
They were
that,
amazing. And also Pat Cashman and his
oh, my
his
God.
Show.
He was hilarious.
He was hilarious.
Hilarious, yeah.
So, yeah, Seattle had some great DJs and mm-hmm some great stations.
And,
but after that era, I just started listening more and more to Spotify. As radio got more corporate and they restricted their playlists more.
And that's the thing is we've been... our dogs are, you know, half blue healer. You think about the way they herd sheep into smaller and smaller mm-hmm and smaller confinements
right
and get them into a pen. That's exactly what they've done with us. Well, you know, they heard us and heard us and heard us until, like, this is what you want to listen to now.
Right.
And when you try to get outside the pen, you know, they say, well, that's wrong.
They and make it easy because they play so many commercials. I mean, it's yeah. always been a problem.
Jim hates me because, okay, we haven't owned a television our entire relationship. Just literally never owned a television. And I won't have one because why bother? There's nothing good on TV. When we stay in a hotel, we end up watching, you know, reruns
like
of I Love Lucy and
Nat Geo
yeah.
documentaries.
There's just nothing good on television anymore.
Just we watch MeTV or
yeah, there's
Decades
literally
or whatever the
nothing good
old
on
geezer
TV
station
anymore.
Is that plays Hazel every day.
Yeah, exactly.
So
why bother? I'm not even going to have one.
Right.
I have a projector. I have a screen. Let's watch, you know.
We have access due to subscriptions to a lot of different
whatever we want. But why
stuff.
Bother paying for cable for television?
They missed the boat.
They did.
Oh, my God, did
totally.
They miss the boat? Because I thought, I remember telling you back before all of this really started happening, it's like, they really, cable TV companies mm-hmm. need to make it more of a kind of a delicatessen kind
right.
of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Or a buffet, you know. Okay, I want one news station. I want MTV. I want Cartoon Network or, you know, I want CBS.
Discovery,
and just take,
science,
and
yeah.
And just take this handful and pay for those individually.
No, but instead
they'd
I get,
make
like,
more money.
I get 17 different ESPN channels and I don't give a crap about sports. You
Precisely.
Know, I get 97
so what
CNN
are we paying
channels
for exactly?
and I don't give a crap about the left-wing
catch up.
Nonsense. Yeah.
And
too
late.
Too little too late.
Too late.
Yeah.
You know, I mean,
and then, of course, they took over YouTube, so they ruined YouTube.
Yeah.
And so we have to go elsewhere, but meanwhile,
where was I going with this? Anyway,
I don't know. You totally totally sidetracked
me. I don't care because
we haven't had a television in more than 15 years and
yeah.
haven't missed it.
The only time was when we were renting a extended stay and TV
right.
came with it. And
yeah.
Even then, we watched reruns of The Big Bang Theory or
yeah.
Seinfeld or. You know, maybe we watch the news, except it's so amusing.
No, we went even further back. We were watching
yeah.
reruns of, crap. We went all the way back. We were doing Mayberry.
Yeah, Andy Griffith, all that stuff.
We were doing,
I'd hook up a DVD player and we'd watch movies. I
right,
mean, it's just,
exactly.
it was crazy. We just don't, and modern TV, and I know And this is understanding that I would actually give one or more of my teeth to be on a network TV show, okay? I ain't going to lie to you, but, you know, there's a lot of copycat stuff, and there's a lot of political agenda, there's a lot of...
Well, that's
why
Roseanne, who basically invented the modern sitcom, I mean, she... is an icon. She,
well, not you wouldn't know it by talking to anybody at ABC programming.
And
that's
the
for
thing
sure.
is they they wanted to get rid of her because she wasn't on their side of politics, and they would have used any excuse they possibly could, and
they found a reason.
They made it up. They made it up. It's not even true, and yet she's bigger and stronger and better than ever. I was never a Roseanne fan. I never liked her.
Yeah.
Never. And now I watch her podcast and I love her.
Her interview shows are really good.
Oh,
she's
my
very
God.
Good at it.
She is so educated and she is so wise. And you wouldn't have known that.
Yeah.
And that's the thing is... You get involved, and you're like, oh, yeah.
Well, I mean, the thing is,
I didn't
though,
like George Carlin either until after he died, and I learned, oh, crap, dude's freaking intelligent.
He was a prophet, for Pete's sake.
Yeah.
He didn't intend to be. He
no,
just,
but the thing is, I thought he was just this vulgar asshole,
no.
pardon my French, and I had no interest in him whatsoever.
Right.
But now I go back and I listen to his stuff, and yeah, he does use swear words and whatnot, but holy crap. The guy was a prophet.
The guy
was literally
a prophet. He predicted all of this stuff
yeah.
that was going to happen.
And we did not align
and
politically.
The thing is,
and still
one of
don't.
His major influences is Lenny Bruce.
And Lenny Bruce, another one.
Another one who was like way ahead of his time.
Way
I mean,
ahead
I didn't
of his
find
time.
Lenny Bruce all that hilarious. The early stuff, I used to have a couple of his albums, and it came with a note explaining the historical context of his jokes. You read that, he's hilarious.
But who he inspired.
Yeah, and, he inspired almost all of them.
Right.
Almost all.
And I'm only familiar with Lenny Bruce through the Fabulous Miss Maisel series.
Yeah. You should watch the there was this cartoon they made of one of his routines, which is
I will do that.
Thank you, Mask Man. It's hilarious.
I will do that.
It's a parody of the Lone Ranger, and it's funny. But you know, a lot of his stuff after a while he's just more interested in talking
about. Comedy used to be mm-hmm. where you didn't toe the line. You demolished the line.
You blitzed it.
And comedy
Richard Pryor and,
was where you said
Lenny Bruce,
all the things you weren't allowed
George
to say.
Carlin,
yeah.
And,
but God, now you have to constantly apologize. You have to constantly bow down to the mob.
Yeah.
And I respect anyone who goes past that line and says, no, screw you, I'm not going
to
apologize.
I mean, Seinfeld and Leno won't even go to colleges anymore. Mm-hmm. That was their bread and butter, even after they got famous. And it's like, we don't want this. This is insane.
No. You shouldn't be locked in Seinfeld right now, he'd be locked in a room as, you know, pro-Palestinians are trying to murder him because he's Jewish.
Yeah, there's that.
Yeah, there's that.
Anyway, I didn't mean to go off on this tangent for, like, near the whole first part of the show. Yeah,
that's what our show's
you know,
all about.
All we do is, you know, I don't want to read a bunch of articles anyway.
Well, articles are there to spur conversation.
Why, certainly they are.
Yes.
They are indeed. And we'll be coming up with some soon. So, you mentioned like about 3 days ago the TDSer of the week.
The TDSer of the week.
And the TDSer of the week is...
Voldemort Zelensky.
Ah, man, really? Oh, somebody was
Actually,
another dumb
I,
celebrity.
I don't think he is the TDSer of the week. I think he...
What do you think he...
Well, he says... Oh, there's no way that Trump could end this war in 24 hours like he says. But he's also saying, come do it.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think he is a TDSer. I think he kind of wants him to. So in an interview on NBC's Meet the Press, Zelensky called Trump's bluff, saying the former president can't manage this war, and invited Trump to visit the war zone and back up his claim. Well, Trump could do that now, but he doesn't have any power.
Right. And,
as
and
president.
By the way, none of this, I doubt any of this would be happening right now if Trump were in office rather than the bumbling fool who sits in the Oval Office
the
and
only reason we're
sucks
in,
on his
we're
ice cream.
In,
sorry, guys.
Yeah.
I don't have any respect left for the man.
I never had respect for him.
I wanted to like him. I wanted to accept him. I wanted to, like, say, okay.
Comedians made
choice.
Fun of him in the 1980s because he was a moron. He's known as being a moron. He was installed like a cheap toilet.
Yeah.
He is not our president. He never will be. He never was. He was installed like a cheap toilet because he is a puppet.
Yeah.
He's nothing but a puppet. They have so much over him. The entire reason we have a war in Ukraine is because he owes them money.
Right. Well, he shouldn't anymore. We sure have tossed enough dough at them.
Well, we as...
Taxpayers,
but him as a guy who doesn't have to pay taxes and has multiple mansions and can travel wherever he wants to, he doesn't give a crap.
Right.
Anyways, Zelensky said, former President Trump said that about 24 hours he can manage and finish the war. For me, what can I say? So he's very welcome. Okay. I think Trump can do it. I really do.
Well, maybe we'll find
honestly
out.
Do.
Maybe we won't. I'm not even sure I'm voting for it. Probably won't be him just because.
We won't have a chance because they're going to kill him. Mark my words.
I don't want to talk about
Mark
that. Mark
my words. They are going to assassinate him.
All right. Well, November 5th, 2023, she says he's going to get killed. I don't agree.
They're going to kill him. That's
They'll
the only
try.
Thing they can do.
I mean, they've been trying
He's too
for the
far
last
ahead.
Several years.
He's too far ahead.
Yeah.
They tried to prosecute him. They tried to do all of that. He's going to win. And their only choice is to kill him. And they will.
Okay. Well, I don't really want to
That's
their
only
deal
choice.
With conspiracy theories like that.
All right. I'm fine with that. I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that.
with the understanding that if you're right, I'll go.
Yeah, and then what they'll do is they'll blame all the Trump supporters for rising up and saying this isn't okay. And then they'll say, oh, insurrection, blah, blah, blah. And then they're going to continue, as they are already doing, mm-hmm. they're going to continue to hunt Republicans. They are already hunting them. They're in jail. They're in prison. They're being hunted.
Oh, by the way, another TDSer, Rob Reiner, says democracy won't survive unless Trump is prevented from running and third-party candidates don't
opposite
run.
Opposite of democracy?
He doesn't know. His...
So democracy won't survive unless we install socialism.
He's a meathead.
Well, no. He's a paid shill.
Yeah.
Nobody tweets.
Oh, by the way,
stupid
what's
garbage
your name
like
on the list that nobody's supposed to have seen? You know,
the list
the guy
that
who didn't kill himself.
Mentioned.
You know that
yeah,
one.
That
is
guy,
it, wasn't your
yeah.
name on that list somewhere? Supposedly,
multiple times,
allegedly,
yeah.
maybe. Yeah.
We're
whatever.
Not saying anything.
Shut
anyway,
up and go home.
Well, believe it or not, ladies and gentlemen, we are at the top of the hour, so we're going to leave you with the tinfoil on your head, and head on into the. The hour mark. We'll come back with we have more weird than wonderful to come back with because we want to share good news, not bad.
Yeah.
And maybe we'll touch into this is why we can't have nice things. But in the meantime, we got to pay a couple of bills. So we're going to head on into the mid-reel and we'll come back with this is why we can't have nice things. We'll be right back after these messages. After these messages,
we'll be right back.
In this digital society, making connections is quickly becoming a lost art form. Yet, if you are a small business owner, building your network is the only way you can get ahead. Can these skills be learned? You bet they can. Read Nose-to-Nose Networking, No-Nonsense In-Person Networking Tips from a Master. Who's the master? Well, who better to teach networking and friend-building skills than a golden retriever? The author, Melanie Hope, takes the antics of Abigail and translates them into the human experience. Through Abby, you will learn how to set your intention, build a network, and get into and out of conversations with grace. Find it on Amazon and Barnes & Noble, in hard copy or on Kindle or Nook. Visit CounterCultureWISE.com for direct links.
Well, there they go again, getting their panties in a twist over something political. This one goes on and on about equal pay, while that one wants a particular pronoun. What is it they want nowadays? Well, I don't remember. Mommy says that the snowflakes have taken over, so I've come back to endorse Wine Away snowblowers. With plenty of hot air and a built-in blowtorch, you'll be able to clear most protests in no time. The next time the snowflakes close in, wine away.
Hello, I'm Senator Wishwash. When I started my political career, I was well known as a straight shooter. I was well known as someone whose word you could count on. I was also well known as someone who couldn't get elected as dog catcher. I needed to do something drastic to avoid having to continue working at a real job. Then a campaign donor told me about Politicil.
From the state-of-the-art CCW labs in an undisclosed bunker in Pahrump comes Politicil, an exclusive blend of vitamins, herbs and secret chemicals that inhibit your ability to speak the plain truth. One pill at breakfast and lunch will increase your ability to obfuscate, placate, and subjugate.
30 years ago, I cared deeply about the effects of my policies on the people I represented. But after years of using Politicil, I can relax knowing my needs are well taken care of while my constituents do whatever it is that people do.
For decades, I've been consistent in my message, and I didn't feel it necessary to use a product like Politicil. I trusted that my basic stance and consistent political message would have taken me to the top. Well, I learned my lesson. I got soundly trounced by Politicil users not once, but twice. Learn from my mistakes and take Politicil today. I don't know what I'm signing, saying, or doing half the time, but my wife Jill and President Harris tell me I've reached the top. Thanks, Politicil.
Take Politicil and feel the power.
Use as directed. Ask your doctor if Politicil is right for you. If your doctor says no, find another doctor. Side effects may include blurred vision, tremors, night terrors, hair loss, and anal leakage. If you experience any of these symptoms or such symptoms as projectile vomiting, loss of speech, excessive dandruff, stroke, heart attack, diabetes, or cancer, do not stop use of Politicil, or you will go back to being the powerless, ethical dope that you were before. Do not use Politicil with our other products, especially Groacet. On second thought, go ahead and use it with Groacet, Lutardian, Give a Shot, Get a Damn Life, and all of our other fine products because we like expensive ice cream, too.
Leaders, listen up. Do you feel like you can't get a dang thing done because of all the namsy-pamsy crybabies that want you to coddle their creativity? When you give orders, are you met with vacant stares only rivaled by a cocker spaniel? It's not them. It's you. You need to shape up or they'll ship you out. Read the Sniper's Guide to Leadership and you will become a more effective leader, communicator, and motivator. Forget SMART goals and learn SWIFT goals. Get the Sniper's Guide to Leadership in paperback, Kindle, and Nook. Today!
Many women enjoy candlelight, wine, and a steamy romance novel. Would you buy anything simply because you like the sound of my accent? Well, then buy my new airbox. Literally boxes of the airs that I have expelled while being extremely French. Available only through CounterCultureWISE Radio.
Hi everybody, this is Jim from CounterCultureWISE with my newest jingle about our store. I don't mean to be intrusive, but just have a look at our exclusive stuff you just can't find in any store. Click on the big store link and find mugs that you can drink from and shirts and hoodies and mouse pads and much more.
What is that awful sound?
Chop it, woman. I'm just getting started.
Oh, boy.
Where was I? Oh, yeah. Buy our crap and come support us. Whatever thing you can afford us. So our mean old landlord does... doesn't throw us in the street. We've got goggle stuff to deck your place and Max's gorgeous orange face and FBI and mooing slabs of meat.
Stop already.
No way, Toots. I'm on a roll. I can't emphasize enough how much you need to buy our stuff so I can live a better life chock full of luck. If after everything I've said I haven't gotten through your head, then it's really clear you just don't give a...
Yeah, no!
I want what I want, woman!
And we want you to check out our great official gear at CounterCultureWISE.com. Radio with heart in mind.
Welcome back to Slumlord U. All right, class. Today we get to do a special arts and crafts project.
This is the Board of Education. We'll hear about this.
No piano in grade school.
Now quit your bitching. This ain't no macrame or pottery or nothing. You're going to have a good time with this one. Trust me. Men, I'm going to teach you how to impress the tenant. And I mean really make them believe you worked for him. This secret technique has gotten me to where I am today, and I'm about to share it with you. So pay attention and take notes. This one thing will convince a renter that you've done your job, no matter what you actually did, if anything. It's a simple visual, and it works like a charm. It's called debris.
Oh, I love brie with water crackers or even celery.
Percy, how in the hell did you get your pinky lifting hindquarters this far in the course? Unbelievable. I ain't talking no foo-foo smelly cheese. I'm talking about the mess you gotta leave behind to make it look like you did something. Whether you actually fixed the thing or not, you gotta make it look like you were actually working. And that means leaving debris behind. Nuts, bolts, bits of plastic or drywall, pieces of wire, you know, that kind of thing. no matter what you do. Never throw away a single thing, and for goodness sake, never clean up after yourself. If you don't leave enough debris behind, folks will think you didn't do nothing.
But what if you don't actually do nothing to make a mess?
Another great question, Cletus. The answer is, you ain't never gonna not do something that doesn't make a mess. That's literally part of your job description. Bernie here has been working with me for a couple of years now. What do I always say, Bern?
A mess ain't always made. Most times it's brought.
That's right, Bernie. Now old Bern here has helped me put together our mess kits, ain't you, Bern? Uh-huh. Why don't you tell the class how we do it?
Gee, Prof. Okay, let's see. On days when there ain't nothing going on, you gotta prepare for when you are called out on a job. Grab your beer and a set of wire cutters. Have fun just cutting up little pieces of wire. Make sure you get all shapes, sizes, and colors. Put them in a pile on your work table. Now go around and find any screws, nails, nuts, bolts, or bits of things that ain't got no match or use. Add them to the pile. If you got any of them little baggies that parts come in, you can toss them in too. If you've done any painting or drywalling, you'll have all kinds of odds and ends to toss in there. You can get real creative-like. I sometimes throw in some rubber bands and paper clips. My buddy Tyson likes to cut up pieces of hose, and when he's feeling real fancy, some bits of PVC pipe. There's lots you can add to your pile. Then just mix it all up all pretty-like and toss it in a bucket or something. Always have plenty on hand that you can just toss around the site. Just grab a fistful and drop it in your pocket. Then when they ain't looking, scatter it around. Now don't go crazy. You want to leave just enough behind for them to think you done something.
All right, great job, Bern. Okay, class, grab a cold one, light your smokes, and join me in the garage where I've been saving up all kinds of things you can make your first mess kits.
Counterculture Wise is proud to present News of the Weird and Wonderful. Here are your hosts, Melanie Hope and Jim Monis.
So it's really interesting how when we write these sketches, it might be me who wrote it. It might be you who wrote it. It might be both of us.
And sometimes they just write themselves.
Sometimes they just write themselves. We have a second episode of SLU
we
tonight.
We do. We have a second episode of SLU.
And this
one wrote itself.
It wrote itself. And I'm going to tell you one last time, this is based on actual things that have happened to us from different landlords over all the years we've been together, and some of them before and at, you know, before that.
But no, these are all based on
but all stuff that Melanie or I or both of us went through.
Yep. But we thought, hey, we've done all the more weird than wonderful, so let's do some more wonderful than weird.
Yeah.
Jimmy, you found this one. I think this is adorable, so I'm going to let you run with it.
This is good. Little scofflaw over here. Anyway. A boy in Florida, where else, called 911 but didn't have a real emergency. Instead, he wanted a hug from an officer.
What?
And the responding deputy understood. Footage from a body cam worn by Deputy Scott Pracht of the Hillsborough County Sheriff's Office, as well as footage from the home's doorbell camera, shows the officer responding and talking to the boy's mom. We had a 911 call, Pracht says in the video. We can talk to my son, the mother says. To be honest, he doesn't even know what 9/11 is. The boy's mom confirms he has a disconnected cell phone, but even phones that are not connected to service providers can call 911,
by the
way. Oh,
so he didn't even know.
Right.
Oh,
so
sweet baby.
That's also a consumer tip. If you have an old phone, just hold on to it. Keep it in your car for use for 911 if you need it.
Yeah.
Really, really good idea. Anyway, her young son comes to the door with his cell phone, and when asked if he called the police, he says, well, I wanted to give him a hug. You called him to give him a hug?
Aww,
his mom says.
That's so cute.
As his mom checks his phone's call log, the boy runs out to hug Pracht, who embraces him back. The phone showed the boy did call 911 at 12:41 that afternoon, his mom says. I know it's your phone number, 911, the boy says to the deputy.
Aw, sweet baby.
After hugging the boy, Pracht explained that 911 is for those who are in trouble and need help. It's very important, he tells the boy. You need to be careful when you call that number, okay? Only in emergencies, and if you're hurt or someone else is hurt, your mom needs help. You know, someone is doing something they're not supposed to do. Give us a call, okay? The boy apologized, and Pratt told him not to worry about it. The sheriff's office posted the video on Facebook on Thursday, where it was viewed nearly 10,000 times.
And probably a million times by now.
OMG, you can't be mad. He called to give you a hug, one commenter
so
wrote.
So sweet.
He was very sweet, and Deputy Pratt is more than happy to give a hug. A valuable lesson learned and a sweet moment shared, the sheriff's office replied.
I want to set up a local phone system, like 611 or what is H on the phone? I think it's 6. Where you can just dial and say, hey, I really need a hug. And I would totally travel out to that person and give them a hug.
Hug patrol.
Hug patrol, yes.
Yeah, okay. So, in a statement, Hillsboro Sheriff Chad Cronister said they deeply appreciate the genuine kindness shown by this young child. Our deputies are more than willing to share a hug and spread love to children in our community. However, it's essential for everyone to remember that 911 is a lifeline for emergencies, he said. We're here to help, and we encourage parents and educators to teach children about the appropriate use of emergency services. CBS News reached out to the boy's mother for further information and is awaiting response.
She probably assumed that his phone wasn't connected and she didn't have to worry about it. And yeah. The sweet little guy just wanted to hug an officer. I think that's adorable.
Well, I think that this sets the boy up for a lifelong respect of police officers.
Right. And the mere fact that one turned up and educated him, that's what... And when I was a kid, that's what police officers did. Mm-hmm. You know, you knew them by name.
You also lived in a small town, so.
Kind of, but not that small. Mm-hmm. But you knew them by name. You knew who was going to bust you for doing the stupid crap you were doing. You also respected them for who they were. And we need more of that. We just really do. Big cities have ruined people.
I would say.
Yeah. Okay. Naz Hassan, a 4-year-old from Syria, was sad to learn that she would have to miss trick-or-treating due to a heart surgery procedure the day before Halloween. But her community made sure she still got to experience the fun of what she calls her favorite holiday.
Ah, okay.
Hassan was born with a very large hole between the ventricles of her heart. We actually have a dear friend whose granddaughter was born with that.
I think my stepdad had that.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, my. Mm. It's called a VSD, a ventricular septal defect, according to her surgeon. Hassan came to the U.S. through the Louisiana chapter of the nonprofit The Heart Gift Foundation, which provides surgical and interventional services to international patients from countries that lack the resources to provide repairs for congenital heart disease.
Wow, I'd like to support that.
I kind of would too. The girl's open heart surgery was scheduled for October 30th. Halloween has always been... Oh my God, she's
so
cute.
She is beyond
adorable. She's precious.
That's future supermodel.
Oh,
cute.
My God, she's cute. Halloween is... Head on over to CounterCultureWISE.com for the archived link so that you can see how freaking adorable this child is. Halloween has always been Hassan's favorite holiday, according to her mother, Shyler Cito, so she was disappointed to miss it. The two were staying at the girl's doctor's house while they awaited surgery. Seriously, she's adorable.
Mm-hmm.
When word filtered out to the neighborhood that Hassan would have to miss Halloween, the community decided to throw her an early celebration. Over 60 houses in the neighborhood participated in Hassan's very own trick-or-treat experience last weekend. It meant a lot, said Cito, the girl's mother. We felt welcomed, and these unimaginably kind neighbors gave my daughter the chance to experience Halloween for the first time in her life. Our host family, plus the neighbors, made us feel happy and included. She's only 4 years old, sweet little baby. This wonderful neighborhood drew a big smile on my daughter's face, and for sure, I won't forget it. We will carry these lovely moments forever. Hassan's open heart surgery, which took 6 hours on Monday, was a success.
Thank God.
Oh, she's such a precious little girl. Well, I just love that. I love communities coming together like that. I love neighborhoods mm-hmm. that would do that. I so want to be part of that. I so want to be part of a neighborhood that would do that. That's precious. What a precious, sweet little girl. May she have a long and happy life. Your turn.
My turn. Okay.
Yours is more weird than wonderful, but...
Well, excellent.
It's also really interesting.
All right. This is odd.
We love science here, CounterCultureWISE, and this is really fascinating.
I don't know if I'm thinking about the same thing you're thinking, or as far as which one is which here.
Oh, okay.
Because I'm...
Okay, yeah, you're right. It is.
I was
different.
Like, oh, now I got to find something sweet and wonderful and things, and I just did.
Okay. Go with grain. Go with grain.
Go with grain. I'll go for the grain.
Yeah, go with grain.
I'm not talking about drinking beer. Yet.
Not yet.
A dramatic
not
video.
Yet.
I got a cold one in the fridge waiting for after the show. A dramatic video surfaced on social media last Friday showcasing the heroic efforts of Australian police officers as they embarked on a perilous mission to extricate a man trapped inside a grain silo.
How did he get in there?
I hope I can find out for you, kid, because I ain't read this in advance. The video initially shared on Facebook by Australia's Queensland Police Service vividly portrays the dedicated teamwork of several officers using their bare hands and shovels to meticulously dig into the grain silo on the 23rd of February. It's an older article, I guess. According to the Facebook post, this daring operation unfolded in Baralaba, a town nestled in the heart of central Queensland. In the midst of the intense rescue efforts, Sergeant Wiley Steele is captured on video urgently requesting additional shovels
to
ensure...
Okay, if you're going
to
be a cop, I think Wiley Steele is like...
That's a bad name for a cop.
That's a...
I mean bad in a good way.
Bad Mama Jamma.
Bad Mama Jamma is captured on video urgently requesting additional shovels to ensure the safety and well-being of the trapped individual, saying, "Can you get some more shovels, mate? We need the ability to protect his breathing."
That was too British. You got to be more Australian.
Oi!
Can you
get
more
shovels, mate?
We need the ability to protect his breathing.
I pronounced it breathing. That's how important it was.
Chad is wondering if there's a grain of truth to the story.
Oh! Somebody kill me now. Somebody kill me now. Somebody kill me. Anyway.
That's why we let people in chat for the bad puns.
The video then goes on. Even bad puns are good, let's face it. The video then goes on to depict a highly coordinated rescue team as they meticulously cut an opening in the silo in a race against time to liberate the man identified as Guy Lost in the Silo.
John.
I'm kidding. His name is John. Senior Constable Callum Moriarty, who played a pivotal role in the sequence in the rescue, reflected on the incredible community spirit that emerged during this critical operation.
But he did not like Mozart, so stay away from him.
Honey, Moriarty's nemesis was Sherlock Holmes.
Whatever. Mozart,
You're
Holmes.
Talking about Salieri,
whatever.
Who's like a totally different
Sully,
person.
Whatever, Mori, they're all the same to me.
Yes, they are. Anyway, you know, the local mine shut. I give up. He noted the local mine shut down, people riding tractors, and businesses along the road rallied to lend their assistance on that fateful day.
You're right, though.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
Great. Fantastic. What happened? How did he get in the dang silo?
I didn't say it. They don't tell us.
They don't tell. I got to find out.
How the living daylights did the dude get in there?
Hold on. I got to find out. There's just got to be some way to find this out.
Let's
For crying out loud. Crying in the mud.
Seriously, how did dude get in the silo?
Come on, man.
Seriously, if you're like in there. As it's being filled with grain, you kind of deserve
it. All right, well, never mind. Sorry, I don't know how dude got in silo. That's a very important information.
Very important need to know information.
For me, it's important.
Very.
For somebody else, it's who cares. But for me, it's important.
No, very important.
Anyway, next.
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 Next. Wait.
Is that all of them?
Yeah. We have to go into the... Now, see, that's why we can't have nice things. Okay. in another round of Is It Racist? Add to your ticket bird names. After years-long discussion, birds will no longer be named after people, a decision meant to disassociate the animals from problematic eponyms.
Everything's problematic. I don't like it. You're problematic.
The American Ornithological Society announced Wednesday that all common English language names of bird species named after people will be changed, along with other monikers that have been deemed offensive. In total, approximately 70 to 80 birds, primarily in the U.S. and Canada, will be renamed. I wonder if the yellow-bellied sapsucker is one of them. Quote, "There is power in a name, and some English bird names have associations with the past that continue to be exclusionary and harmful today," said Colleen Handel, president of the AOS, in a statement.
I would love to have a life like that, where everything around me is so fantastic that I have to worry about a bird being named after some schmo who had a slave 300 years ago.
Me
honestly,
too. I would love
to have that life.
Privileged. Many bird sport names that come from white men with, quote, objectively horrible pasts. According to the group, Bird Names for Birds, all capitals, Bird Names for Birds, a grassroots initiative that has been... What do you bet there's like two people that are members of this at most? A grassroots initiative that has been advocating for this change. Having their names memorialized in this manner is similar to building a statue in their honor, the group argues. The Hammond's Flycatcher, for example, is named for William Alexander Hammond, a former U.S. Surgeon General. Hammond held racist views toward both black and indigenous people, writing that black people specifically were of, quote, little elevated and mental or physical faculties above the monkey of an organ grinder, end quote. Harsh quote. Don't give a crap about the bird. Judith Scarl, the executive director of CEO of AOS, said in a statement that there has long been historic bias in how birds have been named, and scientists should work to eliminate that bias.
Quote, what about the red-breasted don't give a dang? I'm sorry, is that one...
I am the pink nipple don't give a shit. That's my bird name.
I was trying to avoid more foul language to kind of
keep it
PG.
Yeah, I don't care. That's where I am right now.
Yeah, all right.
Exclusionary naming conventions developed in the 1800s, clouded by racism and misogyny, don't work for us today. And the time has come for us to transform this process and redirect the focus to the birds where it belongs.
This whole conversation is for the birds.
Seriously. The efforts toward renaming birds existed before the movement gained momentum in 2020, of course, in the midst of large-scale cultural upheaval surrounding racist and otherwise offensive names,
racist
like those of sports teams and school buildings. You know, all of those sports teams that were renamed against the wishes of the actual people they represented. Redskins. Okay, just saying. That same year, Kristen Cooper, a black bird watcher, made headlines after a white woman called the police on him.
A black bird watcher? What was he being discriminated?
No, he wasn't watching black birds. He was black, while he was watching birds. Okay. A, he was not a bird watcher. B, he threatened that woman with calling her dog to him with a treat so that he could harm it. And C, that woman had to go through retraining, reprogramming, because she was so vilified on social media, because when a black man tried to call her dog to him so that he could harm it, she said no. And they vilified her because she was videoed by him saying, dude called my dog and is trying to harm my dog. And when they said, you know, what does he look like? She's like, oh, he's a black man, blah, blah, blah. Well, apparently, and we've seen this over and over again, if 911 says, what does the person look like? And you say, you know, 5'7", black, wearing this and that. The minute you say black, you're a racist.
Well, they ask
if you say 5'7", wearing a hoodie, blah, 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 and they're looking for, you know, any random guy fitting that description, mentioning his skin color apparently is now racist.
Okay. Sorry, I didn't mean to get us off the topic.
I'm just saying they're using this. A black bird watcher made headlines after a white woman. This is where the Karen thing came in.
Mm-hmm.
They called her a Karen. Called the police on him, highlighting some of the prejudices black people face in the outdoors. He wasn't a friggin' bird watcher. He carried dog treats in his pocket because he didn't like dogs. And when he saw people whose dogs were off leash.
So this is the same guy we're talking about.
Same guy, yeah. When he saw people whose dogs were off leash or he just didn't like them, he would use the dog treats to get their dog so that he could harm the dog. That was his gig. He says it in the video. That he's filming. He's filming the video where he says, I'm going to get your dog. He is the one filming the freaking video. Okay? So this woman was basically ruined. She lost her job. She was completely canceled in all social media. She had to go through retraining. She had to pay a fine. She had to do jail time. Because she pointed out the fact that this black dude showed up with dog treats, tried to lure her dog, telling her point blank that he was going to harm her dog. It's all on video.
Wow.
But she's the one who's in the wrong. And now we have to rename birds because of this dickhead who we know damn well has never watched a bird in his entire damn life.
I
bet
that.
You if you got him in a room and you said name five bird species, he'd be like,
There's
Robin, Batman,
Batgirl.
Yeah.
Commissioner
I
Gordon.
Bet I bet you right now $1 million this man could not name five bird species. And yet all of this is because of him.
I'll bet he feels nice and powerful now.
Oh yeah, he does.
He feels quite empowered.
Oh yeah. He does.
All righty. So, I'm not sure how far Arkansas is from Florida, but this guy is
a
Florida man.
A ways. But yeah, he should be in Florida.
A 66-year-old Arkansas man has been arrested after he allegedly rammed his car through security gates at a South Carolina nuclear power plant and tried to hit security guards.
Yeah, because everybody knows that if you plow into a nuclear plant, that's going to
go well.
End well, yeah.
Doyle Wayne Weisenhunt, I'm going to call him Weisenheimer from now on, of Locksburg, Arkansas, was arrested Friday on charges of attempted murder, malicious injury to personal property, and unlawful entry into an enclosed place after an incident a day earlier. Oh, so he did it once before at Oconee Nuclear Station. Weisenheimer was taken into custody at an abandoned home in South Carolina, police said. The incident unfolded about 8 p.m. when a man drove a silver 2002 Toyota Camry through the facility's exit gates. After the vehicle struck the pop-up barricades that security at the plant activated, the driver backed the vehicle up and proceeded down a dirt road where Duke Energy's security blocked the vehicle in. County Sheriff's Office said. The driver then drove through a fence after attempting to hit the security officers. The man then drove to nearby Pickens County and pulled in onto some property where shots were fired. Sheriff's office investigators said they don't know who fired shots, but neither security officers nor deputies used their weapons. Weisenhunt, or Weisenheimer as I like to call him, was also charged in a separate hit and run from earlier the same evening. Oconee Nuclear Station has three reactors and one of the nation's largest nuclear plants. The plant, located on the shores of Lake Kiawe, began operating in 1973 and includes a public attraction called World of Energy. Come to our nuclear plant!
World of Energy!
World of Energy!
Woo!
Put on this suit so you don't die.
Well,
okay,
yeah.
Nuclear energy's safe these days, you know, but still.
Third generation, yes.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Before I read the next one, Chuck touches lightly on this, and then I think we need to go more in depth, so...
You want to chuck first, then?
I want to chuck
first. Let's chuck this up.
And now, CCW News presents Holy Crap! This is actually happening! No News is Good News Edition, November 5th, 2023. I'm Chuck U. Farley. The big news this week is that it's a slow news week, with little else to report, other than World War III and the 75th Trump indictment. New York's meat-eating vegan mayor, Eric Adams, traveled to Washington, D.C. to meet with lawmakers in hopes of solving his illegal immigrant crisis, but before he could whine to a single Congress member, he had to go back home to deal with an FBI raid on his campaign manager. It seems that during his 2021 run for office, he received some questionable funding from Turkey, where he has been known to travel frequently on the state's dime. While six of his fundraisers have already been indicted, the government has yet to bring any charges on Adams himself. We'll have to wait and see if the well-timed raid shuts him up about his immigrant problem. Speaking of the big rotten apple, New York State police have been going door-to-door, without any warrants, in search of ghost guns. They're using receipts from Amazon to conduct what they call knock-and-talks to bully citizens who may have ordered anything that is perfectly legal, but the New York Gestapo doesn't approve of. As part of their program, they offered law enforcement a free webinar complete with a publicly available comprehensive guide named Ghost Guns, Past, Present, and Future that gives step-by-step directions on how to make your own guns, including 3D printing instructions and patterns. I swear, I am not making this up. Oh yes, and the PDF is available on CounterCultureWISE.com. Shh. Worried about what is in your processed food? While Tyson is adding shrapnel to its chicken nuggets, Wanabana has added lead to their applesauce. No, I am not making either of these up. Meanwhile, as the Biden cabal extorts money from taxpayers so that he can fund both sides of two wars, Ukrainian President Zelensky is complaining that the Israel conflict is stealing his thunder. At a briefing in Kiev, Zelensky said, quote, "It's clear that the war in the Middle East is taking away the focus from Ukraine," end quote. In a move he learned from American Democrats, he blamed the hot war in Israel on Russia. For CCW News, this has been Holy Crap! This is actually happening! I'm Chuck U. Farley. Good night, and may God help us.
So I wanted to go a little bit deeper on this applesauce thing.
Yeah, please. I'd never even heard of this brand before.
Terrifyingly, like, it's simultaneously terrifying and humorous. So the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, the FDA, has received more reports of illness linked to lead-tainted pouches of apple cinnamon fruit puree marketed for children. Now, this company... If you go to their website, they boast, you know, all natural and organic and yardy yardy. Federal health officials are expanding an investigation into potentially lead-tainted pouches of apple cinnamon fruit puree marketed for children amid reports of more illnesses and additional product recalls. Okay, how... How do you grind apples and somehow get lead in them? I'm just.
Maybe the grinding machines have lead in them?
I don't know.
I can't really tell you.
The U.S. Food and Drug Administration said Friday that it has received reports of seven illnesses in at least five states possibly linked to contaminated puree. Two new companies, Schnucks Markets of St. Louis and Weiss Markets of Sunbury, Pennsylvania, announced recalls of certain cinnamon applesauce products because they may contain high levels of lead.
Before we go any further, why would somebody name their grocery store Schmucks?
Well, no, Schnucks. Not Schmucks. Schnucks.
Oh!
Schnucks.
Never mind.
Totally different.
Totally different.
One Abana of Coral Gables, Florida, previously recalled all lots and expiration dates of its apple cinnamon fruit puree. Eating the contaminated products can result in acute toxicity.
Toxicity, folks.
The word, yeah. Parents again. What did I say? Toxicity. Toxicity?
Yeah.
Toxicity.
You said toxicity to start with, and there's no V in toxicity.
Toxicity.
I'm not going to try to say that word again. I only got so many of those in me.
I don't even know what the word was. Okay. Parents and caregivers should not buy or serve the cinnamon applesauce products, which are sold through multiple retailers, including Amazon, Dollar Tree, and Schnucks, and Eat Well Market grocery stores. Children and others who have consumed the product should be tested for possible lead poisoning. Okay, seriously though, are we going to tell us how?
No, they're not going to tell you how the man got in the silo because I checked two other sources and they just said he got trapped in it. And they're not going to tell you how the lead got into the applesauce.
All right. The investigation began in North Carolina, where health officials are looking into reports of four children with elevated blood levels linked to the Wanabana product. State health officials analyzed multiple lots of the product and detected, quote, extremely high, end quote, concentrations of lead. The FDA confirmed the results. How do we get lead into our applesauce?
It can come from numerous sources, the last paragraph explains.
But all the paragraphs are talking about where lead comes from. Okay. Heavy metals like lead can get into food products from soil,
like
air, water, or industrial processes. According to the American Academy of Pediatrics, lead exposure can seriously harm children's health, causing damage to the brain and nervous system and slowed growth and development. I know for a fact that I had lead paint on my crib. There is no known safe level of lead exposure.
Well, yeah, we didn't know the I mean, we lived in houses that were painted with paint made with lead.
We might still, for all we know.
Well,
this joint,
it wouldn't surprise me much
at all. I'll be honest. This joint has given us three episodes of Slumlord University, including this one.
Welcome back to Slumlord U. All right, guys, you have all passed all the tests for your degrees, and I believe that you're going to be the worst slumlords I have ever unleashed on the public. You've all done so well that before I graduate you, I'm going to give you a bonus advanced tip to help set you apart from the rest of the crowd. So here we go. The absolute best rental arrangement you can set up for yourself is a month-to-month. Before I explain why, would anybody like to guess why? All right, Buck, let's hear it.
Easier to get rid of them.
You nailed it right on the head, buddy. If they demand repairs, no matter how reasonable, or question your dedication to their safety or well-being, or even if you don't like how they look, you can just send them the old hasta la vista form. Most of them will just accept it and scramble to find a new place to live. I see your hand, Bubba. What's your question?
What happens if they don't just scramble away, boss?
It's very simple. Volunteer nothing. If they contact you asking for a reason, and this is absolutely critical, so write this down in caps, underline it, highlight it, whatever you got to do, all right? Ready? Say, we don't need a reason. Do not add or subtract from this at all, got it? If you say anything more or less than that simple phrase, it can open you up to all kinds of legal crap, and you might be stuck with these problem children staying on your property for months. So everyone, repeat after me.
We don't need a reason.
We don't need a reason.
That was darn near perfect. Great job. Just remember to say it with no emotion at all. You don't want them to detect any emotion that they can misinterpret, okay? What's your question, Percy?
What if they decide to pursue legal action anyway?
You know, Percy, your questions normally make me want to throw you through a window and then get hammered. But that is a great question. Here's what you do. You tell them that you're going to extend their lease for a month. Say it as if you're doing them a big solid. If you can keep the same emotionless delivery as I mentioned before, that's even better. And this is important. If you are ever forced to do this extension, do it for 1 month only. Do not ask their permission or approval, and don't offer to extend it again at all, ever. No negotiations on this. In fact, don't even allow for the possibility of talking to them about it. Route the rest of their calls to your secretary. And if you don't have a secretary, make one up. You just set up a new voicemail number and have your girlfriend or your mom record the greeting. Then just sit back and watch the voicemails pile up, just like you do with work requests. Easy peasy. Yeah, Jonesy, what's your question?
Like, ain't you concerned about losing rent money?
Not at all, Jonesy. Let me spell it out for all of you in case you didn't understand this before. We don't rent our properties to people who have lots of money and choices. We cater to one clientele only, broke and desperate. Whether they're just temporarily down on their luck or they're in love with their welfare checks is of no consequence at all. The point is, there is always someone in need of our services. I speak from experience here. There is a 95% chance that you can have the place rented out again within 24 to 48 hours of the last renter's moving out. And if it takes a week or two instead, no problemo. You just raise the rent slightly for the next ones. It doesn't have to be much, just 25 or 30 bucks a month, and before you know it, you'll make your money back and then some. You ought to be doing these little rent bumps as often as possible anyway. One last word on this, boys. If you start to feel bad about doing this, remember, we're only interested in keeping it legal. Leave the morality and the ethics to their rabbis, priests, and shrinks, okay? Great. See you all at graduation.
Yeah. Actually, based on real life. I don't want to, we're not going to get too far into it. I think our smarter audience members, which is 99% of you, can infer why we're packing up and packing the old wagon and heading out west.
You know, just, based on the last two,
So, we're good. All going to work out. It's in God's hands, and we're going to handle this. Anyway. Our pain is your pleasure, ladies and gents.
Half of these things write themselves. All right.
That one did. I virtually, it took very little effort, actually.
Very little effort, sadly.
So, let's see.
While you're looking that up, I'll read the next one.
All right, now I've got it.
You got it? All right.
I've got it. Now, my stepdad's part of the family comes from Croatia, from back when it was part of Yugoslavia, and so I've been asked to read this one. This is so ridiculous. Croatian Foreign Minister Gordon Grlić Radman on Friday, notice I knew how to pronounce that, courted controversy after making an awkward attempt to kiss his German counterpart, Annalena Baerbock. I didn't do German.
Yeah, I was going to say, Annalena Baerbock,
while the two leaders posed for a group photograph in Berlin. In a video that went viral on social media, Radman, 65, can be seen reaching out to Baerbock in an attempt to shake hands with her and trying to plant a kiss on her cheek during a photo shoot at the European Union conference on Thursday, November 2nd. During the awkward encounter, the German foreign affairs minister in the video could be seen dodging his affections. Rodman's gesture sparked fierce debate on the internet and prompted outrage from feminist groups. However, the Croatian foreign minister shrugged off the criticism, saying that this was a warm human approach to a fellow colleague. I don't know what the problem was.
We always greet each other warmly. It is a warm human approach to a colleague, he told reporters. Notable Croatian women's rights activist Rada Boric denounced the minister's move, calling it highly inappropriate. Wait a minute, that's not Croatian accent at all.
Yeah. Highly inappropriate.
Ah.
That's better. I just used my stepdad as a model there.
Mm-hmm.
My wife digs this guy. Just absolutely
He's hot
loves
as
my dad.
Hell.
Totally loves him.
The first time I met him was at a karaoke bar, and he sang Phantom of the Opera, and I'm telling you.
I swear, if she weren't with, if I weren't in the building with her, she would have tightened her panties off and thrown them on the stage.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah. And he's, the other thing, he's highly intelligent.
I thought he was, because he was my stepdad, I thought he was a bonehead.
Well, of course you do, but I talk to him, and his wife treats him like garbage because she's a, you know, Biden voting crazy ass liberal. He is an America loving intellectual.
Well, like a lot of immigrants, he actually appreciates America.
Yeah, exactly.
Whereas we grew up and we're spoiled rotten, so there it is.
Yeah, his wife is nuts as hell.
Maybe she's listening. And
she's not going to listen to us. You know she's not listening to us.
Well, if she was, she's not anymore.
No,
anyway.
She's not going to listen to us because people like her only listen to what feeds their beliefs.
You know, you have a point there. You got a point there. She's watching MSNBC right now, and they're the farthest left of anything.
And she's
I've
believing
ever seen.
Everything they say.
Yeah.
He, I'm sorry, he is an intellectual, and he listens to. If you look at people on our side, and I use big fat quotey marks, our side, we listen to all sides. I listen to CNN and MSNBC and all of those. I hear what they have to say. And then I also go to the other side and hear what they have to say. And then I form my opinion. But people who are so deep in TDS, they listen to CNN. And that's it. They listen to, you know, MSNBC. That's it. They do not go outside of their sphere. And that's all they hear. Mm-hmm. So they have no idea what's actually going on. I mean, I literally go to websites that I know are totally biased. I'll go to Al Jazeera and read what they say. You know,
Al Jazeera is more balanced than a lot of the crap we were.
Sadly,
we're,
I will
RT
read all
also.
Of them. I will read all of them, and then I'm like, okay, well, we're somewhere in between these two.
Right, right, right.
But these lefties, they are in such a closed bubble. They don't even know what's real.
Yeah.
And that's something that Scott Adams has been pointing out lately, is he's been looking at, you know, other lefties that are highly intelligent. And we're not saying they're not smart. We're not saying that at all. Highly intelligent, and yet they have these ideas like Trump said to drink bleach, or that, you know, Nazis are very fine people. And it's like, okay, dude, seriously, have you not looked at all the other?
Well,
and
they
don't
want to take it in
they
context.
Haven't.
It's easier
these people,
to just listen to what Don Lamont is telling. Well, he's
right.
No longer
he's
involved.
Not,
but, you know,
yeah,
I mean,
and that's the thing.
And it's America's better for that.
Right.
So
yet, you know, these people still honestly believe that the president of the United States said that we should drink bleach. That the president of the United States said that Nazis are very fine people. That the president of the United States said that all Mexicans are rapists and murderers. They honestly believe that.
I know.
And you can't change their mind.
No, I don't even try anymore.
You can even point out to them, that's not true. This isn't what he said.
No, all you're going to do is just, like, they're going to put their walls up.
And
so
it blows my mind that people would want to believe that. That's what I don't understand. Because even as I'm watching Biden, you know, say just horrifically, horribly racist, awful things, I still don't want to believe that he's that awful of a person, that he's that simple of a person. I still want to go back and say, okay, is he really that dumb?
Yeah, he's the mayor of Simpleton. That's
yeah. And you go back and you research it, and it's like, oh, yeah.
Great song, by the way, if you ever have a
chance. He's literally always been this dumb, okay? Yeah. I don't want to believe that.
Right.
People want to believe that Trump is a narcissistic, racist, you know, go on down the line.
Yeah.
And yet all the proof they have is false.
Yeah.
All the proof they have isn't true.
So let me ask you something about this incident. Do you think, I mean, personally, I think the Croatian foreign minister should have known better.
No, I think it's stupid. I think when I have a foreign minister come to me and hold my hand and kiss me cheek to cheek, I'm like, this is sweet. This is nice. This is kind. This is how we do things. Mm-hmm. I love hugging. It's not like he tried to, you know, hold her and kiss her on her mouth.
Or fondle her boobies.
Right, exactly. If I were to have a foreign minister of any country.
And you were a foreign minister yourself?
Yeah.
Okay.
And I don't give a crap what the country is. If he were, or she even, mm-hmm. were to hold my hand, shake it, and then try to kiss me on the cheek, I would just think it was a sweet gesture.
You're in the minority, Melanie Hope.
Am I?
Yeah, I think you are. These days. I'm not saying right or wrong. I'm just saying I think.
That actually makes me sad.
Yeah, that's a sad situation.
Because I would hate to be in a situation.
Not that he was wrong to do it, but that he should have known what the implications would be if he
But
tried
why? It. What are the implications? That's his culture. Aren't we supposed to celebrate each other's cultures? Yeah. I mean, in Europe, if you're like super duper rapey, we're supposed to just come out and give you flowers, you know, and allow you to rape our children. So why is this guy in trouble because he, you know, kissed somebody on the cheek? It's like, pick your battles, people. Decide what you want to be, okay? Muslims are rapey. They are, because it's in their book. That's what they are told to do. They're rapey. They're going to rape your children. And if you allow them in your country, Muslims are going to rape your children. And yeah, I sound like a jerk, but it's the truth. They're rapey because Muhammad was a child rapist. He was a dog-hating child rapist, and Muslims are rapey. So if you allow them into your society, they're going to rape your children. And if you sit there and say, oh, that's okay, fine, your children are going to be raped. That is a huge, gigantic, monolithic difference from some guy from another country who wants to kiss your cheek. Okay? But you're supportive of the rapey Muslims because you don't want to seem, ooh, racist or Islamophobic. No, being afraid of Islam is not a phobic, okay? Phobia is a unrational fear. Being afraid of something that is actually dangerous is not irrational. And Islam is dangerous. And I know we just got booted off of YouTube for this, but I don't give a crap.
Booted off of where?
Whoever.
I mean, honestly, I just don't care about YouTube.
And probably YouTube, several different.
I think on
we've probably
note,
been booted off of Apple and all the other ones. Yeah. I don't give a crap. Islam is rapey. Islam.
How did this go to? I'm sorry, I'm not sure how we got.
Because they're trying to say this guy, who, innocently, according to his culture, tried to kiss somebody on the cheek. They're trying to say, oh, that's a big, you know, feminism, blah, blah. Shut up. They're trying to make that a problem.
Yeah.
But when Muslims flat out rape people, behead people, do the things according to their doctrine are okay. Well, we can't say anything about that because that would be Islamophobic. No. Phobic means that I have an irrational fear. I do not have a fear of spiders. I know what kind of spiders we have, and I respect spiders where they are. I am not phobic of sharks. I have a healthy fear of great white sharks. I'm not going to swim where great white sharks are. There are certain species of sharks that like to gnaw on humans. I'm probably not going to swim in those areas.
That makes sense.
That doesn't make me phobic. That makes me cognizant of...
There's actually a sort of wisdom involved in that.
Exactly.
So...
Muslims hate Jews. They want to exterminate Jews. It says so in their book. It says so.
Clear. I believe you. I haven't read the Quran at all.
Honestly,
so I don't know.
In black and white, in their book, exterminate the Jews. That is not a phobia. That is a knowledgeable concern for racist a-holes that are trying to exterminate an entire race. That is not a phobia. Islam is a cult of hatred and evil, and I will not back down on that. And you can ban me, you can silence me, you can relegate me to, you know, whatever. Islam, and I know this firsthand because I've read the Quran and I've studied their religion, Islam is a cult of hate. Of hate. And they hate Jews. And right now, what we're looking at is a world that is trying to exterminate the Jews, which kind of sounds like, oh, I don't know, 1940s Germany. Just saying. I'm just putting that out there. If you support Hamas, if you support Palestine, which isn't a real thing, and you can go back and read on or listen to our history of Palestine, if you support them, you hate Jews, you're a racist, and you want to exterminate them. There is no left or right on this at all. At all. It's clear, and it's obvious, and it's easy to point out. I don't have to go back and watch the video. You say, oh, Trump said he supported Nazis. No, he didn't. You can go back, you can watch the video. He said very clearly, I'm not supporting those. I'm not supporting them. He said very, 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 very clearly he's not supporting them.
Okay.
And yet you can come out and say, oh, I want to exterminate Jews. And we're supposed to support that? No. I don't. I don't support war at all. I'm just going to be honest. I don't want there to be a war at all. I don't. I don't want babies being killed at all, ever. You invaded Israel. That's the only place they have. You know, if you're Muslim, you have like a dozen places you can go.
Including the United States, really.
Including, yeah. You have more than a dozen places you can go. There are multiple Islam states. There is only one Israeli state. Just leave them alone, for God's sake. Just leave them alone. Okay. You can go anywhere else on the planet. Leave Israel alone. Then you don't have to worry about things.
Since we're rounding up to the top of the hour, let's finish on a positive note.
Let's. You're the one who said it. Let's.
Aren't you playing the introduction?
Oh, I guess
you know,
I can do that.
That's what I'm waiting
on.
Oh,
you want the stinger. Here you go.
Here on CounterCultureWISE, we may rant, we may rave, but most of all, we go against the current culture because we believe, to the core of our beings, that humans are good and the world is an amazing and beautiful place. At the beginning of our show, we give you news of the weird and wonderful, but that is just the tip of the magnificent iceberg that is our world. We now present news of the wonderfuller.
All right, Jimmy, go ahead.
All right, speaking of the Middle East.
Speaking of.
All right, let's see here. Hello, sir, she said to him in Hebrew as the darkened, secured room where she and her 95-year-old employer had been hiding for hours while their house in the kibbutz near the Gaza border was broken into and ransacked. It was the climax of a morning of terror on the national nightmare that was October 7th for southern Israel when thousands of Hamas terrorists from Gaza... Wow, okay, they didn't pull punches. Okay, excellent. Thousands of Hamas terrorists from Gaza overran nearly two dozen locations and would carry out the worst one-day attack on the Jewish people since the Holocaust. It was just a day earlier that Camille Jasalva, 31, from the Philippines, was enjoying a party at Kibbutz Nirim with her employer, Nitza Hefetz, marking 77 years since the communal farm's founding in 1946. That's what a kibbutz is, by the way. It's a commune. The two looked at photos together of past holidays that they had shared over the last 4.5 years since Jasalva began working for her, had a drink, and celebrated together. All the caretakers at the kibbutz had gathered there and felt as one with the residents, she said. In a twist of fate, Jasalva was actually supposed to be on vacation in the Philippines, but had postponed her departure to be at the kibbutz gathering and then got delayed again, finding a substitute to take her place. Yet that night, Jasalva didn't sleep well. She said she had a premonition something bad was about to happen. At 5 a.m., she was already totally awake, 90 minutes before the sirens would go off, warning of incoming rocket fire. Accustomed to years of intermittent rockets launched towards Israel from the Gaza Strip, the two women went into the safe room, thinking it was just a routine attack. But the red alerts kept coming, and Hefetz wanted breakfast. Jasalva ran to the kitchen to bring the easiest thing she could get as the elderly woman dozed off. Hours went by. Then the electricity suddenly went out. Jasalva heard gunshots. She tiptoed around the house to see what was going on and noticed someone had broken in. She frantically messaged her employer's son that she had heard noises in the house. The door was ajar and the window open. Soon enough, she heard people speaking Arabic in the house. At first, she wondered if it was Israeli soldiers. They were so loud and noisy, I realized it was not the military. Well, of course, you know, they tend to be loud and noisy, these Hamas people.
Yeah.
She recalled an interview with... I'm just getting one last dig in. In an interview with JNS. Just so you know, Melanie, I'm on your side here.
Okay.
Jasalva, who had worked in Dubai before coming to Israel, then understood that Arabs were in their home, and not friendly ones. She messaged her mom in the Philippines that she didn't know if she would survive and to send her a picture of her six-year-old son. Before I close my eyes, the last thing I want to see is my son, she said, breaking into tears.
Sweet girl.
The memory of that fateful day still fresh in her mind. Four times a terrorist would enter the house. At one point, she had to muffle Hefetz, who asked her if she was calling her son so that the attackers wouldn't hear them. Great job, lady. Anyway, Hefetz saw the caretaker was crying, so she quieted down. But on the fourth attempt, a terrorist suddenly entered the safe room of the house, whose door did not completely shut, the flashlight from his cell phone illuminating the darkened room. Hello, sir, Jasalva said to his face. Where is the money? He asked. The elderly woman woke up from the news. Go home, she told him. Nitza, please be quiet, the caretaker pleaded with her employer. She saw I was scared, so she shut up, Jasalva recounted. I'm sorry, sir, she's old. She doesn't know anything, she told the attacker, who had shown a flash of anger. Where is the money? Jasalva got her wallet off the table right in front of him and took out $375 in cash, all the savings that she had amassed for a planned trip the following week to the Philippines. Please, sir, don't take my passport or my ticket for my flight, she urged. Is there more money, he demanded. No, she responded.
Of course, that's all they were interested in.
After searching the overturned house, she walked him to the door. Thank you, sir. I'm closing the door now, she told him. He nodded at her and walked out. The nightmare had ended. For the next 2.5 hours, she lay huddled in bed, trembling and sobbing violently next to her employer, who clutched her and embraced her. She had this look on her face. I love you, she said, and smiled like a doll. If it wasn't for Nitza, I would be dead, she said. The whole house is broken, she texted her employer's son again at 12:28. They took all my money. But the two women escaped unscathed. Later that afternoon, the Israel Defense Forces arrived and rescued the women, taking them to the very kibbutz social hall where they had attended the party a day earlier.
On the way there, Gisalva saw burnt cars, bullet-riddled houses, and other destruction from the hours-long attack. Families were separated at the dining hall. She realized they got off lucky. Elsewhere in southern Israel, two Filipino caretakers were taken hostage by Hamas in Gaza, while four were killed. The next day, the women were taken to a hotel on the outskirts of Jerusalem. I kept asking myself, am I alive or maybe I'm dead, she recounted. The following day, they were brought to the Nofim Jerusalem Assisted Living Facility, where they were offered every possible care and where Hefetz celebrated her 95th birthday. It was a new life for me and for her caretaker said. We knew from the start that we were blessed with a wonderful and committed caretaker, said Hefetz's daughter, Anat Ben-More, 70. Wow. The sun is ancient. Okay. So now we know that in addition to all her attributes, she's very courageous and quick-witted. For now, Gisalva has again postponed her trip to the Philippines until her employer gets more settled down. It's all God's will, she said. God gave me the strength.
Oh, well, baby girl, God bless you and her. I hope you make it back home to the Philippines, because, yeah, you faced, you stared hell in the face, and you made it.
All right, and now Melanie Hope, let's clean this all up and put a nice happy bow on it. Hit it, Melanie Hope.
Life is meant to be lived in color.
Ding, ding, so when
a group of fifth grade students found out that wasn't exactly the case for one of their colorblind classmates, they took action. They've been keeping a secret, which is huge. Christina Hayes, a teacher in Glen Hope Elementary School in Colville, said, for 10 and 11-year-olds, keeping a secret is really a big deal.
Yes, I can attest.
It wasn't long ago that Hayes and her students discussed their favorite colors during class when they realized that Jaron Casillas didn't have one, or more specifically, he couldn't see them. It's pretty much all colors, Jaron said, when asked about what colors challenged him. His mom, Lindsay Casillas, remembers the day she found out her son was colorblind. I heard him say, Mommy, look at that beautiful green sunrise. Jaron has trouble with lots of shades, tints, and combinations. For greens, purples, and blues, he sees gray. Trees are yellow. And the colorful classroom and world around him has been different until his classmates decided to take matters into their own hands, collecting their allowances and donations to buy Jaron special glasses. And not just one pair, but two, for indoors and outdoors. I am not crying, you're crying.
No, you're crying.
No, not me.
No, you're absolutely crying.
No, I'm
not. Tears are streaming down your face like...
Shut up, you're crying. I was just like, is this what everyone else was seeing this whole time? It just makes me feel thankful because I didn't know they would do this for me. I know my friends are true for doing this for me, Jaron said, and his mom agrees. The hearts of these children in a time like this, it gives us all hope, she said. I think he sees what true friendship is and caring people around him, and I hope he carries this with him and remembers this for a long time.
This, by the way, is Colleyville, Texas. It was local-ish. So, wonderful, wonderful way to end the show.
That's the way sweet babies treat each other. And that's the way I hope that you will treat each other out in the real world.
By the way, this Tuesday is the birthday of Melanie Ann Hope, Esquire, the creator, producer, and co-host.
Animator.
Of this, pardon me?
Writer.
Writer and chief bottle washer for this great podcast. So on behalf of all of our friends and fans.
Send us dough. Help us move.
Come on.
Give me a birthday present.
I wasn't trying to turn this into a fundraising.
I'm okay with that.
Although, honestly, really, go ahead and send us the money. We'll take it. I don't give a darn. You're amazing. And I love you.
I love you too. And I love you who are listening. Thank you so much for being part of our family all these years. May God bless you. May God bless your family. And may God bless everything that you do, including how you care for your pets.
CounterCultureWISE is a Stormcat production.
Thank you for joining our growing family of listeners. All links from the show are available on our website, counterculturewise.com. Find our archives on any of your favorite podcast hosts.
We engage in satire, commentary, and generally laugh at the ridiculousness of our crumbling society. Our only medical or financial advice is to not follow any financial or medical advice given by podcasters.
Our animations, interviews, holy crap segment, and other videos are put out on BitChute and Rumble, and only in part on YouTube because they hate free speech.
Our show is entirely funded by listeners like you. Visit our ever-expanding merch store or our Subscribestar, where you can get outtakes, extra videos, and sneak peeks.
If you would like to be a guest on our program, feel free to contact us via our website. Just click on the link at the top that says, Be a Guest on Our Show.
For more fun and cat pics, please visit our Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram. For complaints about our show, please fill out the ID10T form on our website, and we will give it the attention it deserves.
Meanwhile, no matter how cruel the world may be around you, always remember the importance of kindness. Be kind to each other, be kind to animals, and be kind to yourself. See you next week!